Okay, first day on the mission. Some people will fly out, you know, from the Salik Airport and go to their mission. That did not happen with me. We, you know, other missionaries were getting their, you know, their itineraries for the airport and what flight they're leaving on and that kind of thing. We were like, meet the van at, you know, 3:30 in the afternoon. We'll drive you down to Ogden, you know. It's like, oh, great. In fact, I remember distinctly, we even exchanged our Book of Mormons with other missionaries and they exchanged them back just to say we'd exchanged Book of Mormons on the trip. Because we were driving a van of missionaries down. You know, a lot of missionaries say, I'll give out a Book of Mormon on the airplane. So we did that just because kind of a honorary. We gave out the Book of Mormon to somebody. It was another missionary, but still, it was good. We drove up to Ogden. And you know, Ogden is not much different from Utah. It's well, because it's part of Utah. Ogden's not much different from Provo. It is, however, a great place. And I remember driving through there, thinking, "Wow, there's a lot of brown." I'm from California. Utah is very brown compared to California. It's a desert, right? And I just remember thinking, oh, I miss the green. But it was amazing because when we got there, I learned to love the people. We got to the Mission Tabernacle, and this was, or to the Mission Office, which was originally part of the Tabernacle that now is situated by the Ogden Temple. And the Ogden Temple, which looked very different when I was there, it looked a lot like the Provo Temple. It and the Tabernacle were where we had the mission headquarters, basically. And I got there, and the assistants, first thing, the assistants take us out to tract, to proselyte. And I was so scared. I was so scared. I was like, no. I had some self-confidence, but I was like, ah. Like, we're going out. I mean, should we plan? Shouldn't we, like, you know, open up the area? And I was just making excuses. I just didn't want to go out and tract. But, you know, I remember the assistant was like, hey, no, Elder, we're going out. And we went out, and we were in a part of Ogden, and Ogden has a reputation of being kind of a place that's not so great as far as conditions of living, that kind of thing. I think when some people think of Ogden, they think, oh, it's a ghetto. There are some parts that are like that, but a lot of Ogden is actually, I really like it, and not a bad place to live. And however, we did start out kind of in a more of a ghetto-like place. And I remember being intimidated. I remember being scared. I remember, are these people going to be interested in the gospel? The first two people we spoke to were Spanish. That didn't help. Luckily, my companion knew a little bit of Spanish. But I was still just scared. Silly. I was like, hola, me missionary of Jesus Christ. I was stunned. I was just like, I don't know what I'm doing. Again, though, I had to remember, I can mess up. I can make mistakes. This is going to be okay. I don't need to be perfect. God can work through me. And we actually ended up talking to some big, good, great people. And gave out the Book of Mormon. And I remember coming away from that experience thinking, this is going to be all right. I can talk to people. I can just open my mouth. And, you know, people don't think we're maybe as weird as I think they do. Then, of course, I learned later that some people think we're weirder than I thought they would think we were. But still, it was amazing how easy it was eventually to learn to talk to people. And part of that might just been the nature of Utah. People know who the Mormons are. People know who the church is. And that has pros and cons. Some of the pros of being in Utah is that most people in Utah have heard of the Mormons. Some of the cons of being in Utah are most people in Utah have heard of the Mormons. I was surprised and shocked to learn that Utah has an extremely high baptizing rate, though. And I don't say that because I think baptism is the marker of success. The fact that Utah has higher baptisms than, say, another country or another state really isn't any indicator of the work of the missionaries, but really, it's the members. It is all the members. This is what I learned being in Utah, is I got to work with so many members. And this was one of the things that I really studied and really worked to develop, was my ability to gain the trust of the people we worked with, particularly the members. Because what happened is, in Bountiful, of all places, in Bountiful, I had more success than I had in inner city Ogden. In part because, at first that might seem counterintuitive because Bountiful is so densely Mormon. But it was because of that dense Mormon population, because good examples of several of those members, that we had so much success. We would go out, we would work hard, and then we'd get a call. You know, and this is usually what I felt happened. Get a call and say, hey, So we've seen you out working. We want to invite our friend over to have you teach them. And it was just amazing at that. I mean, the way Utah works is you do not tract at all. At first we did, and there's some parts of Ogden that we'd still go around and track a little bit. But I remember my first night there, I was with my first companion, Elder Inky. And Elder Inky and I knelt down and we planned, and Elder Inky said, "Hey, what do you want to do?" And I was like, "Hey, oh, let's go track." And he just, I remember distinctly kind of chuckling to himself, being like, "Okay, Elder, whatever you want to do." We tracked this first street in Bountiful, and every house was a Mormon. By the end of going through that street, we had already had pointed out to us like the two houses that were not LDS on that street. And he was like, "Oh, they've been visited, you know, several times." And so it was a very different ballgame, you know, than a lot of other missions, because it's so dense. You know, a lot of wards have maps where they know who's a member, who's not, that kind of thing, who's less active, you know, and so you have a lot of resources. And so it's just different. You make friends, you serve, you work a lot with the members, and then when the time is right, you know, you share messages, you encourage them to come out, to invite their friends to hear about the gospel. And as you really work to uplift the members, to enable them, to work with the ward councils and the ward mission leaders, to show them that you're willing to work really hard, it's amazing what happens when that happens. Working with members, President Monson said in Preaching the Gospel, there's a quote in Preaching the Gospel where he says that there is no better way than working with members. And I would honestly feel comfortable modifying that and say there's really no other way than working with members if you really want to have a strong amount of success, particularly in a Utah mission. Utah is terrific because, again, you work with the members a lot. They take care of you. You're fed very often. I think different mission presidents have different roles about how often you eat with members. It's very tempting sometimes, just because of the way, just because the prevalence of how many members there are, to kind of just develop some really chill relationships with some members. And one of the most enriching part of being on my mission was my relationship with members of the church. I still will see some of them from time to time. And we had some families who invite us over for breakfast some mornings, or to dinners more frequently. And those relationships were great, as long as they did not distract you. And this is a danger, as long as they don't distract you from the work. It's sometimes easy to get chummy and to forget your purpose. And so I would just caution, you know, any missionaries there, it's actually surprising how fast, and I think we only had one, I personally had like one strong instance of this. It's amazing how you can lose trust by becoming too chummy with members. You know, there's that great story of Elder Bednar having these missionaries come over and just kind of like take their time and just do whatever. And Elder Bednar's like, "I'm not giving any referrals to you for my friends, because you haven't come here with a sense of purpose. You just kind of play basketball with my kids and that kind of thing. You're great friends, but you're not great missionaries." And the missionaries came back later and, you know, came back, you know, had dinner, shared a great thought, asked for referrals, used their time super wisely, were, you know, not too anxious to get out the door, but not too anxious to stay and linger. And Elder Bednar is like, "Okay, now I can give you my referrals." And that's a great story, I think, because I saw that and acted out so many times on my mission experience. So work hard with the members. Work hard around the members. We had a saying in our mission, "Every member a mission president." That's because, you know, everyone, when you go to Walmart, and when you go to stores, and when you're out and about, there are people all around you who are Latter-day Saints, who will judge their idea of their missionaries on you. You may not even be their missionaries. But if you do something dumb, you lose trust really fast. And so we just had to be careful. We had to be, you know, we could still have fun, but we had to be careful. And just as an aside, a funny story, I remember in my first area, we were in a grocery store. And I mentioned earlier, I was in a singing and dance group. And so I was kind of just like, tap my feet to a particular routine I knew. And my companion, Elder Inky, was like, "Stop it. stop it, stop it. And then this kid comes up to me and says, hey, are you a tap dancer? And Elder Inky was like, because he was right next to me. He was like, no, he's a tap dancer. I'm a missionary. Just chops off mock fury. And, and it was just fun. But just reminded me, it was one of those little instances of, you know, you're always being watched. You're always just always going to be in your best. And I think when you really realize you're the Lord's servant, you're his representative, that's going to happen. So that's great.